It's All Things Considered, and I'm Dave Lawrence. It's become a tough week for music fans. Following the death of Mary Wilson of the Supremes Monday, today we learned another prior guest on the show, Chick Corea, passed away Tuesday at 79, according to his website, from a rare form of cancer which was only discovered very recently. In 2016, we got a chance to sit down with the one-time Miles Davis keyboardist and founder of Fusion Innovators Return to Forever, when Chick brought a trio including Eddie Gomez and Brian Blade to the Blue Note Hawaii. We'll include the complete video of that interview in our feature at hawaiipublicradio.org, and right now offer highlights in memory of Chick Corea. Thank you very much, Chick.
Yep, sure. Nice to be here.
Saying that, is there a particular Hawaii memory or experience that you've got?
I came here and I rediscovered the Pink Hotel because my wife, Gail Moran Corea, and I, when we got officially married in the 80-something, we always say our marriage date is 72 because that's when we came together. But we didn't get married till 85 or something like that. But for our honeymoon, we came here and Gail loved the Pink Hotel. It's the Royal Hawaiian, I believe. And we're staying now at the Outrigger, and out my balcony, I spotted it. I said, there it is. It's still there. So I took a photo of it and I sent it to Gail and she cried. So So we're going to come back at some point. I'm thrilled about that.
The Pink Palace, they call it. And what was the year that you said that?
I don't remember. I think 85, something like that, you know.
One of the things that's important in talking to you guys is early music education. One of the things about you is that early music experience. Trumpet playing father. At such a young age, you were able to have that develop into playing the piano at just 4.
Well, first of all, that's something, this whole thing about how we came up in music is shared by the three of us, which is that we didn't go to music college. We came up through, the ranks.
The street.
Basically, we naturally discovered the value of playing with great musicians as a way to learn how to play music. That's the way we did it. We always worked with each other. So when you mentioned schools, my mentor, Juilliard, I mean, I lasted 1 month on the regular program, but Peter Schickley, who later after that was P.D.Q. Bach, the comedian, but he was an amazing musician. So he came in as a substitute teacher for a couple of weeks, and that was my favorite. That was my best memory at Juilliard. Aside from, Eddie and I met at Juilliard.
When I think of education, that's why I mentioned your father. And when you're that young, it's also education can come from just exposure to people. It doesn't have to be in a formal environment.
Yeah, exactly. It's an education in a sense, getting involved in what you love. And my dad was a trumpet player and a band leader, and he introduced me to music. My mother was a hardworking lady, and when I was 4 years old, she spent $45. That's what I was told, to get this huge upright piano that needed to be put, lifted with a crane into our third floor apartment that we lived in. So I got started early, like by my dad.
Chelsea, Mass., just outside of Boston.
Chelsea, yeah. Red Devils, that's the football team.
I went to Emerson, right in the same general area. Talking about that, people giving you the opportunity for an experience, one of your earliest is Cab Calloway. You talk about people opening the door for you, sort of what you were saying earlier about the value of folks giving an informal education, which turns to be just as important as a more formal one. Explain for folks how something like that emerged in your life and at that, what was still a very early age.
Well, it was just a natural thing from one thing to another. I mean, once I discovered that the most interesting, fun thing about my daily life was music, I just kept doing it. You know, I just kept finding friends who were into music, musicians who were into music. Out of Chelsea, when I was in 8th, 9th grade, started going to Boston more, started meeting musicians older than me in Boston and connecting up. My whole life has been that way. My connection and my team and I consider that my group is musicians. It's just one thing after another. Like, for instance, this trio is, even though I've known Brian and played with Brian in a lot of great situations, and I've known Eddie even longer since 59, we've made a lot of music together. This is a whole new experience now because as a trio, we've never played together before. So again, I'm discovering like, wow, you know, it's a challenge. How do we do this and so forth? It's a rich and adventurous life that way.
And a lot of lessons are kind of like that. Sometimes having a mentor or a band leader that you're working for can maybe be difficult, but at the same time, extraordinarily nurturing or leave behind a legacy of work. I'm thinking about Miles. Obviously, it wouldn't be right to not include him in the conversation with you. You had developed a lot of things. By the time that that emerged in your life, you were well on your way. But it happened, and if you can paint a little picture for us of how it emerged, how you got the gig, and now that you're looking back on it, we're talking about lessons and things that we picked up from people along the way. No doubt there are some in that chapter of your life.
Well, I had the same experience these guys had joining Miles, because Miles was the dream gig at that time, and I had followed Miles since I first heard him play. Gee, it must have been 1949. My dad had vinyl recordings, and Miles was playing as a young man with Bird's band, with Charlie Parker. And I first heard him there and fell in love with his sound and his phrasing. And so every solo recording that Miles made, starting from the first one in 1951 called Dig, all the way through just every one, I was just there. I followed him. So by the time the call came to go play with him, it was pretty exciting. But I had a similar experience because I was working with Sarah Vaughan, who was another hero of mine. And I got the call to go to work with Miles, and it was tearing with me because I didn't want to miss it. So I went ahead and I scurried. I got on the phone and I found out that Bob James had been playing piano for Sarah Vaughan, and I knew that he had just left the gig and I had just taken his place. So he knew the repertoire. He knew Sarah's repertoire. And there was a gig coming up. I didn't want to let her down. And I begged him on the phone to please at least do a couple of weeks. And he was reluctant because he had already started off on a new thing, you know. But he was kind enough to do it. He made it work for me. I told him how important it was for me. So then I went and I appeared in Baltimore, this club in Baltimore, and my first night with Miles. It was an amazing memory.
Are some of those shows nowadays? I was talking with your manager before we got on the interview, how YouTube has really changed things in the world. And one of the positive things that it's brought is there's so many concerts now that people can take a look at online and experience. And some of those are things that weren't officially released. You did a bunch of things that were released with Miles, but things like thinking about Isle of Wight, when I think about Tanglewood, maybe 1970. You look back at that stuff. Are there particular lessons you can point to about what it was like working with that kind of band leader in those situations, maybe his demands, expectations for the crew?
Well, like I told you about all the years that I was following and looking up to Miles and learning from the musicians that he chose, like there was a whole line of piano players that played with Miles that were all of them my heroes. So by the time I got to play with him, every night, I was with him about 2 years, 2.5 years, and every night, every time we were together was a special moment for me. Even after that, after I left the band, every time I'd meet him, it was always special being around Miles, because he sort of was he was the beacon for us of musical freedom and of musical certainty. Like, one of the things I loved about watching how he worked is he never thought about asking for a license to do whatever he did. He was never looking to have someone let him do it. He would just did it, whether it pleased certain groups of people or not. He lost some audience, then he gained some audience, kept changing. And that freedom of creating. And the other thing that was amazing about him that I already loved to do and that really got solid in that band is the group, the feeling of working in a group. Like, Miles really, he wanted the musicians that worked with him to think for themselves and be free. He never gave any directions, ever. We never rehearsed. Occasionally he'd say something, and then it would take weeks to figure out what he meant.
Well, that's one of the things about bands, that there's a lot of special exploration, and you've got a great trio here. It's been a pleasure getting to talk with you guys, and thank you, Chick. Great having you on board.
We appreciate it. Yeah, thanks a lot, man.